All right, let's go through these. So in part two, we talked about like our negative exponents. Remember, anything with a negative exponent is going to move from the numerator to the denominator or vice versa. If it's in the denominator, it's going to move to the numerator. So if you look at number one, it says 48 over negative 4 to the negative 3. The 4 to the negative 4 to the negative 3 is the one that has the negative exponent. So that's going to go to the bottom. It's going to become 48 over negative 4 to the third. And then the negative is inside the parentheses. So this is negative 4 times negative 4 times negative 4, which is 64. And then we can reduce this. Okay. You can do, if you wanted to start with 4, this would be 12, and this would be 16, and then 4 goes into that again, this would be 3, and this would be 4. Questions on that one?
Isn't it negative 64?
Yes, thank you. Just making sure you're paying attention. It's negative because it's negative 4 times negative 4 times negative 4. So that should, thank you, Madeline. That should have been a negative 64. So that negative can be out front, like negative 3/4. It could be in the top. It could be in the bottom. Doesn't matter, as long as it's only in one of those locations. All right, number two. You've got exponents on the outside of the parentheses. So that's what you want to take care of first, okay? These, I can actually switch these while I'm in here and say this would be y to the third over x to the second because they're both negative. And then on the right, I want to distribute that in, so it's x to the second over y to the second. And then when you're multiplying, we multiply straight across. You can actually cross-cancel these. X squared and x squared cancel out. And y squared cancels with two of the y's in that top, leaving you with just y to the first. If you had multiplied first across, you would have gotten x squared, y to the third, over x squared y to the second, and then you would still be able to cancel from here. You'd still end up with y. So you don't need the first on there. It is y to the first, but you don't need the one there. Questions on that one? All right, number three. Lots of stuff going on here. You've got this negative that's going to get distributed in. Then you've got this negative that's going to get distributed in again. So you can do them in either order. I can either distribute first and then go, or one at a time. So the negative on the inside is a to the negative 2. B, negative 2 raised to the negative 1 means I'm going to multiply those, right? So it becomes squared. All raised to the negative 1. Distribute that negative 1 in, multiplying it on the exponents, and I get a to the positive 2, b to the negative 2. B is the only one that's got the negative, so the a squared stays in the top, the b squared moves to the bottom. And there's my answer. Okay, 4. Distribute the exponents first. So this 3 goes to all three places. This is 4 to the 3rd. A to the 2nd raised to the 3rd, I multiply them, so it's A to the 6th. B to the 5th raised to the 3rd is B to the 15th. Second set of parentheses, distribute that in, and this is negative 4 to the 3rd, negative 3rd. Then A to the 2nd raised to the negative 3 is A to the negative 6th. B to the 6th raised to the negative 3 is B to the negative 18th. I'm going to take care of these exponents here that are on the coefficients. So this would be 64, a to the 6th, b to the 15th. This would be negative 64, a to the negative 6th, b to the negative 18th. From here, I can move my exponents, or anything that's got a negative exponent is probably what I would do next. So I have a to the negative 6 and b to the negative 18 that are there. You can either multiply these first, adding the exponents, or you can move them, whichever one you want to do. So I'm going to do the first, which is just moving them. 64 is going to stay in the top. A to the 6th is staying in the top. B to the 15th stays in the top. Negative 64 stays in the top. Oh, sorry, this is a negative 3. Negative 3. So that's still to the negative 1. So that 64 is going to go to the denominator. Then a to the 6th is a negative 6, so I move that to the denominator. And b to the negative 18th, that's a negative exponent, so I move that to the denominator. Now these cancel. A to the 6th cancels. And there's a b to the 15th in the top, a b to the 18th in the bottom. Remember, when we're dividing, we subtract the exponents, but we leave it where it's bigger. So this becomes b to the 3rd. And I end up with 1 over b to the 3rd. The negative can be out front, in the top with the 1, or in the bottom, doesn't matter. So the other way to do this, again, is to multiply combining your exponents first and then moving what you need to. So if I did that, I'll do that here. This is 64 to the first and 64 to the negative first. If I multiply those, right, I get a negative 64, and then 1 plus a negative 1 is to the 0 power. And actually, the negative's on the front, so this needs to be like this. Okay. Then I'd get a to the 6th and a to the negative 6. That's also a to the 0. And then I'd get b to the 15th and b to the negative 18th. That's b to the negative 3rd. So the negative is still going to stay there, but anything raised to the 0 power is 1. So this is 1. This is 1. And b to the negative 3rd moves to the denominator. So either way, you get the same answer. And you just got to pick whichever method like your brain leads you to, okay? Because obviously they're both right. There's a lot going on in that question, so be really careful. The more steps there are, the more opportunities to make silly mistakes, so be so careful. All right, then 5, a minus 2. So this whole thing is being raised to the negative 3, which means I move a minus 2 to the 3rd to the bottom. Then a minus 2 is being raised to the negative 1, which means I move a minus 2 to the 1st to the bottom. There's still a 1 in the top. And these, although their expressions are the same base, which means this becomes 1 over a minus 2 to the 4th. Now you don't need to expand it. You can leave it the way that it is. We're going to get into multiplication and stuff in that Wednesday section. So for right now, that answer would have been good. Questions? All right. Part 3. Now you were dealing with your fractional exponents, right? So remember that the base slides over to the front and the top drops down once you're simplifying. This already had the steps of having to do one more thing than just converting, okay? So like number 1 said b or 5 to the 3/4 times 5 to the 1/4. When we're multiplying, they have the same base. We're going to add the exponents. So I get 5 to the 3/4 plus 1/4, which is 5 to the 4/4, and 5 to the 4/4 is the same as 5 to the 1st, which is just 5. Questions on that one? Okay, now number 2, you've got a little bit more going on. You've got exponents inside, and then you're raising it to an exponent, and then you've got the denominator. So the first thing I'm going to do is distribute this 20 into both of these. So a to the 1/5 times 20, and b to the 3/4 times 20. I could put 20 over 1 if it helps you with the fractions. All this goes over a squared. 5 goes into 24 times, so this becomes a to the 4th. 4 goes into 25 times, so this becomes b to the 15th over a to the 2nd. And then I can cancel 2 of these a's, leaving me with a squared b to the 15th. Still with me? Yeah, okay. Last one, ax to the negative 2/5 times x to the 17/5. So when I'm multiplying, I want to add the exponents because the bases are the same. Negative 2/5 plus 17/5. And that becomes x to the 15/5, which becomes x to the third. So it didn't happen, but remember, if I was to just write that as a root, like, so what we didn't do is something like 8 to the 2/3, right? This becomes the cube root of 8 squared, which becomes 2 squared or 4. So just a refresher on the fractional exponents, right? If they are fraction and you need to simplify them because it's a number and not a variable, you want to slide the bottom over and drop the top down. So let's start here, right? Okay, so this is the homework from Friday. Number one should have been 4 to the second or 16. Number two, x to the fourth. So I'm gonna read them out loud if you are one of those people that has to split your screen because you're only on iPad and not two devices. I'll read them out loud so that you can jump into Notability and check them, okay? But then if you've got questions, make sure you come back. Number three is 6 to the 7th, and you don't need to work that one out. Remember I said like anything, I would say anything over the fourth, you probably won't have to work out. You could leave it that way. But if you had a calculator, you could have used that too. Number four is 2/3 times r to the third power. Number five is 4n to the 7th over 3m to the 7th. Number six is -4r to the 6th. Questions on those?
In number four, why would it say it's 2/3 times r to the 3rd? Why wouldn't the r to the third be in the numerator?
It can be. So if you have it 2r to the 3rd over 3 like that, these are the same things. Okay. You're good. Yeah. As long as you don't put that r in the denominator, it's fine if it's next to it or in the top, because technically that's r to the 3rd over 1, which is the same thing. Yeah, either okay. One's fine. Good question. Okay, number seven, 625 over a to the 10th. Number eight, p to the 4th over 5. Number nine, 1/2pq. So 2pq is all in the bottom. Number 10, 4/a². Number 11, 13. Number 12, 2. Questions on any of those? All right, number 13, -4/3. Number 14, no real solution. Remember, you can't square root a negative number. Number 15, 4. Number 16, 1,000. Number 17, -27. That negative is raised to the third power, so it's odd, which makes it a negative. Remember, the negative is always the last thing on there. So you would not leave that negative underneath the fourth root. 18, 256 over 81. 19, 9. Questions on those? All right, so this is it the negative?
Yeah, because I got no solution.
So the negative is not in the parentheses, remember? which means it's the last thing that gets applied.
Okay.
So if you want to start doing that, like if it's not in parentheses with it, rewrite it that the negative's bumped to the front so you remind yourself that's what you need to do. So then that becomes negative fourth root of 81 raised to the third power, and you can fourth root a positive 81. Yeah.
And then so if it was in the parentheses a negative, it'd be no solution.
So if it was like this, no solution.
Okay.
Yep. Good question. All right, so 13 is negative 64 over 27. It doesn't matter if you keep the negative with the top or the bottom because it's just one negative. So I would separate those out. This is negative 64 to the 1/3 over, let's say, 27 to the 1/3. And then 1/3 is cube root. So cube root of negative 64 over cube root of 27. Now, hopefully, as you practice these, you start to get familiar with especially these like more popular cube roots. But let's say we don't know it yet. 64, okay, if you broke it down to 8 and 8, then it becomes 2 and 4, 2 and 4, 2 and 2, and 2 and 2. So we need 3 of one number to bring it to the outside. There's 1, 2, 3, 2s, so 1, 2 is going to come outside. Then there's another 3 2s, so I bring another 2 to the outside. And when you bring more than one number, which we're going to practice today a lot, when you bring more than one number out, they get multiplied together. And it's negative, so it's a negative 4 in the numerator. And then in the denominator, 27 is 3 and 9, which is 3 and 3. There's 3 3s, which means the denominator would have been 3. Okay, 24. 21k to the 2/3. 22 is 1 over x to the 10/3. And you're going to leave it like that because I'll tell you today why we don't leave radicals in the denominator. So you could leave it with the fraction in the denominator like that. Six over m to the 1/4 times n to the 3/4.
For number 21, can you put a radical for that one?
Yeah, because these are in square root form, in exponential form, I would say probably leave them that way. I'm not sure how we're going to format these answers, to be honest, if it's going to be multiple choice or if it's going to be where you have to type it in. And if that's the case, then it's going to be easier to do the exponent. But we will have that. Hopefully, Ms. Ferrier is meeting with administration today to talk a little bit about quizzing and testing policies, and I should have all that information for you tomorrow. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
If it's homework, sure, I take both answers. Any other questions on that last bit before we jump?
Could you go back to the second page really quick?
Okay, so the first thing you want to do is distribute your exponents in, right? So if I distribute the exponent into each of these, it's going to go to all three places, right? So the top one would be 16 to the 1/4, and then m to the 3 times 1/4 becomes 3/4. Over n to the 1/4. Then I'm going to multiply the 1/2 in on the other ones. So I get 9 to the 1/2. N to the negative 1 times 1/2 is n to the negative 1/2. Over m to the second raised to the 1/2. 2 times 1/2 is just 1. Then I want to combine my terms here, which I can actually simplify the coefficients here. This is the fourth root of 16, which remember is 2 and 8, 2 and 4, 2 and 2. There's 4 2s there, which means that's 2. M to the 3/4 over n to the 1/4 times 4, 9 to the 1/2 is the square root of 9, which is 3. The n to the negative 1/2, I would move to the bottom because it's got a negative exponent. And then m to the first stays there. Good so far?
Yes.
Okay. Now I'm going to multiply the constants or the coefficients there. So I get 6. If I put them into 1, it's m to the 3/4 over n to the 1/4, n to the 1/2, and m to the first. Now we got to mess with all those exponents. So if I have the exponent in the top and the bottom, remember I want to subtract, right? So what's bigger, 3/4 or 1?
1.
So I'm going to subtract the 3/4 from the 1, so my 6 is going to stay where it is. And I'm putting it where it was bigger, which the 1 is. So 1 minus 3/4 is 1/4. And those are gone. And then the n to the 4th and the n to the half are in the bottom. So I want to add these. 1/4 plus 1/2. This becomes 2/4. And so I'd get 3/4. N to the 3/4. Which was the answer.
Can you go back to number 17?
Sure. All right, so again, I posted this, like the worked out solutions, and this was on, like the answers were on Friday's video, but I wanted to go over any questions you might have. So anybody have questions from 1 through 5 on that first page from Thursday's homework?
I had a question on 15 and 16.
Awesome, okay, I'll jump right there. Okay, so 15 said n to the 3 to the w times 3 to the 5 minus w times 3. Technically, this would be to the first. So I keep the base the same, and I'm going to add up all my numerators. So w plus 5 minus w plus 1. Now, the w and the negative w are going to cancel out, and then you've got 5 plus 1, which is 3 to the 6th. And I would have taken 3 to the 6th, right? Like, I would say probably, like, I'll tell you exactly what I would expect you to go multiply out. But if you had your calculator and you multiplied that out, this would also be 729. And then 16, same thing. The base is the same, so I want to add all my exponents. So 2, 5 plus b plus 3 plus 3 minus b. And I get 5 plus 3, that's 8, plus 3, that's 11. And then positive B and negative P are going to cancel out. So it's just 2 to the 11, which is 2048. That would be fun to do 2 to the 11th without a calculator. You'll never have to do that. Any other questions on this assignment?
So you never, like, multiply 2 times 2 times 2, you just leave it?
If it's that big. Like, if it's 2 to the 4th, 2 to the 5th, I'll probably, like, I'd tell you, I'd say if it's anything like 5 and under, you multiply it out. Or if you have your calculator, I might say you got to multiply it out. So it's just going to depend on the format of the answer.
No, like in the actual question, you know how, like...
The base? No. So when you're multiplying and the bases are the same, you keep the base the same, you add the exponents.
If they're different, do you multiply?
You'd keep them separate. So if it was like 2... Okay. Yeah, well, if it's numbers, if it was like 2 to the 3rd and 3 to the 2nd, you would actually work that out. So it'd be 8 times 9, right? But if it's x to the 2nd and y to the 3rd, you can't combine those into one. That's how it would stay.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Everybody else good? All right, so we are going to get started the notes. All right, for part 4 of P2, longest section ever, okay, which is radicals. Again, something that hopefully that you've seen before. This should be review, but I don't want you to panic if it's not, because we're going to go through it again. And again, we've like quarantined brain, which means we haven't actually remembered anything. And then you can start the homework tonight so you don't leave a lot for yourself tomorrow, but it won't be due till Wednesday because we won't finish the notes till tomorrow. All right, so simplifying radicals. To simplify a radical, we're going to use a factor tree to simplify them, which we did a little bit in last week's notes, but they're going to get a little bit jazzier, okay? When the index is 2, it's a square root. So if it's a square root, the index is 2. If it's an index of 2, it's a square root. That means you need 2 of that number to bring the number outside once. So what does that mean? If I had something like the square root of 20, right? Obviously, this is not a perfect square. I would break this down, and no matter how you break it down, you want to go all the way to the primes, which would be 2 and 10, 2 and 5. And then because it's a square root, I need 2 of that number to go to the outside, so I cancel both of these 2s by bringing 1, 2 to the outside. 5 does not have a match, so it stays underneath. And that's how I would simplify square root 20. You can also do, okay, this is 4 and 5, and the square root of 4 is 2. Bring that to the outside. That works the same way. It's just the bigger the number, the harder that's going to be. So if you can identify a square root, bring it out that way, that's fine too. But the bigger the number, the harder that is. When you're multiplying two radicals, you can multiply any two square roots. You would keep the index the same though, so it has to be a square root. You can multiply any two cube roots. You can multiply any two fourth roots. You cannot multiply a square root and a cube root, okay? I can't get that together. But if I do have two square roots, then I keep them both under the root and I multiply what's underneath. So this would be the square root of 6. Sometimes you can then simplify. This case, not so much. So if I had square root 2 and cube root 3, I can't do anything with those. Those would stay as they are. And when you're dividing, you can simplify two square roots. If they are both, again, underneath the square root, you can simplify them before you do anything, which we're going to learn how to rationalize. You can simplify them that way. So if I have square root 10 and square root 5, they're both under the root. 5 goes into 10 two times. This becomes square root 1, which goes away. And I just get square root 2. So you can simplify underneath a square root, as long as they're both square roots or both cube roots. Okay, questions on the rules before we get to the examples? All right. So number one, square root of 28. I'm going to break that 28 apart. What does 28 break into?
14 times 2.
14 times 2. Is 14 prime?
No.
Nope, I got to keep going. So how does 14 break down?
7 times 2.
Okay, 7 and 2. Now, those are all primes, right? There's two 2s, which means 1 2 goes to the outside. The 7 doesn't have a match, so it stays underneath. All right, you do too. All right, how many of you broke it down into 2 and 24, 2 and 12, 2 and 6, 2 and 3? Saw that there was two 2s. So 1, 2 comes to the outside. Second 2 comes to the outside. 3 stays underneath. That's 4 square root 3. Okay? How many of you did it that way? Broke it all the way down? Okay, good. Other way to do it is you could say, well, 48 is 16 times 3. 16 square rooted is 4. Just be really careful and make sure you're really comfortable with your square roots if you're going to do it that way. It's totally fine. They're both right. Okay? Some of us are faster than others with the square roots, which is totally fine. All right, number 3. Now, what happens here is there's already something on the outside of the square root. So we just did 48, right? We broke it down and we would end up being 2, 2, 2, 2, and 3. So when I bring out the first 2, it's going to get multiplied by the 2 that's already there. Bring out the second 2, multiply it by what's already there. The 3 is the only thing left underneath, and this becomes 8 root 3. So if you bring more than one thing to the outside, you multiply them. If there's something already there, you're going to multiply it by what's there. And you do 4. So 6 square root 45. All right, so 45 breaks down into 5 and 9, which is 3 and 3. That means the 3s go to the outside, get multiplied by the 6 that's there, and the 5s left underneath, and I get 18 root 5. Questions on those? All right, let's keep going with some examples. So number 5. 14 square root 75. 75 is, and you can break it down a lot of different ways, but I can do 3 and 25, which is 5 and 5. That means 1 5 is going to the outside with the 14. 14 times 5. 70 square root 3. Ten times 125. 125 is 5 and 25, which is 5 and 5. Now, there are 3 of the same number, but I can only bring these out 2 at a time because it's a square root, not a cube root. So I bring out 2 5s out front with the 10. 1, 5 stays underneath, and I have 50 square root 5. Number 7, 600. Numbers are just getting bigger, right? So I can use, I tend to try to use 2s because I know that's prime. I'm going to break it down eventually there anyways, but you could do 6 and 100, break it down however you want. 2, 300. 2, 150. 2, 75. 3, 25. 5, and 5. Now here there are 2 2s, so I'm going to bring a 2 to the outside. 2 by itself is going to stay underneath. Then there's 2 5s, so I'm going to bring a 5 to the outside. 3 by itself is going to stay underneath. So on the outside, I have 5 times 2 times 5. And on the inside, I have 2 times 3. So if I bring more than one number to the outside, I'm going to multiply those. So this would be 10 times 5, 50. If I leave more than one number underneath, those are also going to get multiplied out. So it's 50 square root 6. So if you have a variable, let's say I have the square root of 25 x to the fourth, okay? You would treat the 25 separate from the x to the fourth. So I could simplify 25, right? That becomes 5. Questions so far. Oh, what? Okay, last one, and then we'll stop for the day. 5 root 3 times 2 root 3. So I've got 2 numbers on the outsides. Remember, these can be multiplied together. That's a 10. And then I get a square root 3 times a square root 3. So what happens when I multiply a square root by itself?
Doesn't it stay the same?
It actually gets rid of the root, right? So this is just 3. If you don't see it, which is a trick you want to just know because it makes your life so much easier. If you multiplied these out, it'd be square root 3 times 3, which is square root of 9, and the square root of 9 is 3. That will always happen. So when you multiply a square root times itself, the root just goes away, and this would be 30. Questions so far? All right, so I'm going
to go back to...
just try to ignore that. All right. So if I had square root 25x to the fourth, I can split that so I can focus on the number and I can focus on the variable. But the square root of 25 just becomes 5, and you can simplify the number anyway. So if it was square root 20, you could break it down. But your exponents, think about what's happening here. This is 1, 2, 3, 4 variables, right, of the same, and you need 2 on the outside. This means 1x comes out. This means the second x comes out, and I get 5x squared. But the bigger the exponent, the less you're going to want to do that. Like if it's 15, I don't want to write out 15 x's and group them together. So the rule on the exponent is take the index and divide it into the exponent. So if I had the square root of x to the 16th, and this is really a 2 on the outside, that is x to the 8th. If I had the cube root of x to the 15th, I would do 3 into 15, and that's x to the 5th. If it doesn't divide evenly and you have a remainder, that remainder stays underneath the square root. So if I had the square root of x to the fifth, right? 2 goes into 5 2 whole times, so x squared goes to the outside. But there's still 1x left, so it would stay underneath the square root. So if it doesn't divide evenly into it, then the remaining x's or variables get left underneath the square root. All right, so I'll do another example of that tomorrow, but basically where we're at today, you can complete the whole second page of the assignment. So start there, and then we'll work our way onto the first. All right, guys, it is 8:55. Have a great day. I will see you tomorrow, end of the day. Bye, guys. Bye. Have a great day.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.